Hello and welcome back to Homeschool Together. We're going to be continuing our around the world journey where we follow our journey from country to country as we blend together the Torchlight and Build Your Library curriculum. If you have a chance, if you like our videos, head down and hit subscribe, like the video as well. If you have time, head over and look at our podcast as well. Subscribe there if you don't want to watch us, you want to listen to us. That's another way to do it. So this week we were in Ireland, Scotland, and England. So we were kind of in the British Isles this
week. The UK, yeah. It was really fun. We could have spent well more than two weeks here. Yeah. It was really tough, you guys.
It was.
There to stop ourselves.
A lot of books, a lot of movies, and a lot of illness. That was kind of our... So we always talk about we like to focus on two things, but we actually focus on three things. We had two bouts of colds.
One was the flu. One was the flu.
Wasn't COVID. Was the flu. Definitely the flu and a cold. So we kind of had to readjust our focus. We did a lot of reading. Yeah. But we did a lot of cinema as well. And so, you know, kind of a nice little thing to do. So as you're going around the world, it's going to take a long time. Things are going to happen. Holidays, family, illnesses.
Yeah.
You want to kind of adapt. And I think this is a good example of us adapting to the curriculum this week. It was kind of a nice little blend.
You know that we normally really love to cook. We didn't actually cook at all.
No foods.
Through this entire 2 weeks because we were so sick.
Because I can't taste anything.
All right. We focused on watching a lot of terrific movies. And there were even more. These are just the ones we watched and we'll talk about today. And we focused on reading a lot of Scottish and Irish folktales.
Yes.
Which we found some fantastic books to read those. So we can go ahead and get into it.
Absolutely. So, first one is Paddington.
Yes, A Bear Called Paddington. The very first
There'll be more on Paddington later in the episode.
But this is the first book by Michael Bond.
Yeah.
And this is... I thought kind of, you know, this is the book that Build Your Library recommends that you read. I really felt like... Or maybe it's Torchlight. I can't remember. One of them recommends you read this. And I really thought it was a little bit dated. It's clearly from like the 40s. And I felt like, okay, Paddington gets into scrapes. It's much like the movies when he gets into issues. But I didn't really connect with it all that much. There are, I think, 5 books maybe in the series, at least that we have in our box set. Our daughter could not wait to read the second one.
Well, but both girls had a big Paddington thing.
She wanted us to keep reading... she was like, when are we going to read the other 4 books? And I thought, this was a little dated. I didn't really enjoy listening to all the old-timey department store stuff that happened to Paddington. He got stuck in the window display. Things like that I didn't connect with as much anymore. My daughter absolutely loved.
Well, you can get really cheap copies of these books. You can get them at thrift. So they're pretty much everywhere.
One thing that I liked about Paddington was that the chapters, I want to say there might be 8 chapters, that they don't have any direct flow into one another. There's nothing that references back other than the very first chapter. Mm-hmm. So you could almost read these like short stories. So if you want to pick one, that there's one where he goes to the seaside, one at the department store, one where he does a painting. There's different ones. You could almost choose one that your reader's interested in if you don't want to read the whole book and just choose one of those because there's not really a through line. Read the first chapter and then pick what you want. But my daughter loved all of it. So it was, I guess, a hit for us. I didn't really love it myself, but she sure did. Our 6-year-old loved it. So Paddington.
Speaking of food that we didn't get to eat, O'Sullivan's Stew.
Yeah, and I want to say...
Little warning on this one. It's longer than it looks. This looks really thin. I can read this in a few minutes. This is a way longer book than it looks.
It has terrific artwork.
Wonderful.
This is kind of an Irish trickster tale where this girl is getting her father and brothers out of trouble with the king by telling these fanciful tall tales. I do it in a terrible Irish accent. My daughter absolutely loves it.
We will not do it here.
We will not do it here. Yeah. But my daughter really loves it.
We'll leave bad Irish accents to Christopher Walken.
We will. This was really, really great. Our daughter absolutely loved it. I can't remember which curriculum recommended it, but O'Sullivan's Stew is really great if you want kind of an Irish trickster tale.
Mm-hmm.
This one you could almost read it in segments too because she tells different stories about each, the brothers and the dad. But it's just got some super imaginative, great illustrations. Our daughter loved it.
It's well worth a purchase. We actually own this book.
We own it,
washi tape on the side, and we've had it... earlier. We actually read it. Mm-hmm. I think Torchlight had this as one of their book recommendations.
Yeah, I think that we'll probably read it again maybe around St. Patrick's Day because it was just so fun and clever. So yeah. Really liked it.
So we can recommend two books here.
Katie in London.
You want to do some walkabouts in London. There's two books to do.
Right. So Katie in London was recommended by Build Your Library. So we bought this book and I really love it.
She basically goes to Trafalgar Square. And the lions come alive, and they take her on a journey through the town, through London. And you see all the famous locations and famous stops. So it's really nice because there's so many, famous places to go and visit in London. It's really nice to kind of get a sampling. And then you have a very similar idea here in A Walk in London, a little bit more not as fantasyful. It's just a mother and a daughter kind of going around London. Again, very nice stylized graphics here. It's a very quick read. But there's a little bit extra embedded within the picture. So if you read the main story, there's a little bit additional stuff here. I loved using both of these books as kind of a touchstone into some YouTube videos, deeper learning pictures, things of that nature. So both of these books were just like a great touchstone into more learning.
Yeah. So if you can't get Katie in London, which is the recommended book, they are equal substitutes in whatever your library has. Definitely check out one of them, though. Yeah. They're really good.
Absolutely. Next one is The Secrets of Stonehenge. So you go to England, you want to at least get a little bit of touching into Stonehenge. Mm-hmm. I really like this. It was very reminiscent of Magic School Bus type of thing where you can read the central story and then there's additional descriptions on the outside that tell a little bit more of a deeper story. Just more of what I liked about this is it told the historical evolution of Stonehenge, but also a little bit about the people that kind of created it. So you got kind of like early prehistory in there. Mm-hmm. It was really, really nice. I liked it. My daughter really loved it. And again, another touchstone to watching videos and things like that.
I think this would be really good too if you plan to do a prehistory, ancient civilization thing. There is also the Who HQ. There is a Where is Stonehenge book. So if you have a slightly older learner that you're doing this with, I'd recommend checking that out. It wasn't appropriate for our 6-year-old, but if you're doing this with a 7 or 8-year-old, definitely check out the Who HQ Stonehenge to go with this.
Okay, so into Ireland, lots of leprechaun stories. You read them, a bunch of them. If you have to have a leprechaun story, we actually enjoyed this one the most, the story of the leprechaun.
I didn't love any of the leprechaun stories as much as like purchasable, but our daughter would not let us get away without reading about leprechauns. We read, I think, like 6 books about them. Mm-hmm. This is the story of the leprechaun.
And you said it was the... You said a lot of them were very strange.
They were very strange. I didn't know that the original, I guess, legend of the leprechaun is that they were supposed to be cobblers and they make fairy shoes. I did not know this. I've seen a lot of movies with leprechauns and nobody ever talked about fairy shoes. But anyways, they were in all the books. So if your child really wants to do a leprechaun-based story for this, the story of the leprechaun I felt was the best. We also read A Magic Treehouse Merlin Mission about leprechauns, which was really good for a light chapter book. And there is an accompanying study guide, Magic Treehouse book that goes with that, where you can get more history about it. And that's a nonfiction resource to go with The Magic Treehouse. So we'll link it in the show notes. I can't show it here because I read it on my Kindle to my daughter. Mm-hmm. But in typical Magic Treehouse fashion, it was easy and easy to understand for a 6-year-old. It was kind of perfect. So, but if you want a picture book, this was the best one of all the leprechaun stories we checked out.
Absolutely.
So if you have a better leprechaun story, put it in the comments because we would love to know about it.
Okay. We don't edit our podcast because we go one shot, but I heard some rustling with the baby up there, so we don't want to have her interrupt us too much. All right, so back to the regular scheduled program. Fiona's Luck.
Yeah, so this is another kind of a trickster tale from Ireland. This was really good. I don't think this is like an absolute pickup, but if it just tells a story about Fiona tricking the leprechauns. Yeah. So this has a little bit to do with leprechauns, but it doesn't have much to do with leprechaun folklore. So that's why we recommended the other book. Mm-hmm. But this one was really sweet. It had good message in it. And if you need books on Ireland, I think this is a good pickup. Mm-hmm. I don't know that it's a must have, but we enjoyed it.
Absolutely.
Fiona's Luck.
Next is... We should show them all at first, or maybe we can get a couple.
Right, well, so they have this series of books called Traditional Scottish Tales, and they're going to all have this seal on them, and they have some plaid down the side.
We have a bunch of them. We'll show them all.
But, yeah, there's 5 of them. These, if you're like a publisher, these are the way to do folktales. First of all, they're gorgeous. Yeah. They're each illustrated individually. The pictures are just stunning.
Mm-hmm. The Tamlin one was very good. I also like the Dragon of Stormworm.
They tell just terrific stories. Mm-hmm. We loved them all, really. So this is the tale of Tamlin, yes. The Dragon of Stormworm.
The Selkie girl was very good.
Right.
The Secret of the Kelpie was really nice. A water horse, and pairs with another movie that we watched. Mm-hmm. So really good. And then the Loch Ness Monster.
So our library had all these. So any of these books that you can get, there are others in this traditional...
These are the hardbounds and these are the paperbacks.
Right. Yeah. Any of these traditional Scottish tales that your library might have, pick them all up because they're all good. They all have beautiful artwork and great stories. Mm-hmm. And I love the way that they took traditional folk tales and they didn't take out like all the strangeness, but they just made them... They made them more cohesive. Sometimes we read folktales and we kind of don't know how they got from A to B. These books were just really good at painting this picture.
Yeah, they were refined and tightened, and it actually told, like, I think a continuous story.
Yeah, more cohesive stories. Our daughter loved all of these. And in fact, I think we read all of these twice because she loved them so much. So any of these traditional Scottish tales that you can pick up at your library, we highly recommend.
Absolutely, absolutely. So then let's talk about a couple here. Follow me around. So we always like to recommend short... Yeah. Nonfiction books about the countries. So if you have a learner who wants a little bit more of a deep dive into the country, a little bit more facts and figures, a little bit more information, we've recommended a bunch of different types of these flavors. This is the first time we've done the Follow Me Around.
Right. This is, I think, a new series that's just come out from Scholastic, Follow Me Around. And it talks about, it's a child in these countries. And we have the UK and Ireland
here.
And it just shows, you know, facts and figures and things, but really easy to uptake. It's not quite as easy as the next. You can show the blast off readers.
The one thing I like about these is that it's centered on a child. And I've noticed in the past with like the children around the world or a school like mine, my learner identifies a lot better with, you know, little kids and their experience in the country. And if she feels like a kid is telling her the story, she really enjoys that. So this is something that I liked. It was a nice wrinkle to these types of books, these little non-fictional books.
So these ones I think are more, this is probably a child who's probably 10 years old.
Yeah.
And the information in them, I would say, it is maybe a little bit more advanced for a six-year-old than these books.
Yeah.
These blast-off readers definitely have information that's a bit more geared towards that really early elementary.
Yeah.
This might be more of a mid-elementary, but... Our daughter really still liked them because, as you say, they talked about kids.
Yeah.
But just know that in the level of difficulty of reading, definitely the blast off readers and then the Follow Me Around will be kind of like the next level up.
Absolutely. All right. So those are the main books that we recommended for this week.
Yeah.
Next into cinema. So we'll start with the 1-2 punch. Paddington 1 and Paddington 2.
We got them from our library. We did a bunch of library DVDs this time.
I mean,
we were so sick.
Paddington is one of those movies where it's just pure heartwarming. There's really like almost, you know, no objectionable material. It's all just kind of slapsticky gags.
It's all great, right? Because he gets into trouble all the time. And so, it is all slapsticky. The first one does have to do, if you have a sensitive child, the first one does talk about basically the villain wants to like kill and taxidermy Paddington. Our daughters didn't quite get the villain, Nicole Kidman's motives. And
very,
so that
very
was
evil
okay.
Nicole Kidman, yeah.
If you have kind of a sensitive 101 Dalmatians type kid who's very sensitive about that kind of thing, you might just go to Paddington 2, which didn't have anything like that in it. So just a note on that.
Yeah.
They were both really charming, though. Our 2 and 5-year-old loved them.
I believe Paddington 2 has a 99% tomato rating on Rotten Tomatoes. So if that's any indicator, if you understand what that means, that's an indicator of the quality of these movies. Both of these
really
movies
good.
Are highly reviewed. They're just very enjoyable, very sweet.
Our kids wanted to watch them again and again, so
absolutely.
They really enjoyed
it. Well, even the little one, the 2-year-old, even enjoyed
she
it as well.
She loved it.
So the kid who would be king.
So we really enjoyed this one. This is also has a fresh tomato rating.
An Arthurian tale. So.
And this is a modern kid in England who gets Excalibur, and all of a sudden he's got to get together his knights, and you know it was really great. Our daughter loved it so much she wanted to watch it the second day. One of the things I would say about this, if you want a very quick, like, 3-minute synopsis of the Arthurian legend, you could probably check out a clip from this. The very beginning of this is an animated tale of King Arthur. So if you just want to watch the 3-minute clip and you don't want to see the whole movie, that beginning tells, like, the background of who Arthur was and the Knights of the Round Table and the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
actually in a really concise and easily understood way, because I was worried my daughter wouldn't get all the references, but that was perfect. So if you want to check that on YouTube, maybe we can find a clip and we can link it. But this was a great movie. Our daughter really enjoyed it.
Absolutely.
Kids save the world kind
of
thing.
So Irish movie, Secret of Rowan Inish.
The Secret of Rowan Inish. So this was a more quiet movie. This is an Irish kind of a mythical tale about, this is again a Selkie, seals turn into people. Story. This was a bit quieter. Our daughter did enjoy this, but I would say that this might be more geared towards like a 7 or 8 year old child because it was quieter. This is definitely not loud. This is kind of a contemplative, slightly sad story that it ends well, but just know that this is a bit quieter. If you have a kid who's not as patient, this is not a good choice for that.
Absolutely. Song of the Sea.
Okay, so
these are the same people who did The Story of Kells.
The
right?
Secret of Kells.
Secret of Kells, yes.
Right, so if you've seen that, it's an Irish animated movie, which
did it win Best Picture that year?
I don't
think
so.
It was up for Best
so.
Picture that one year.
It was very, I remember it being good, but maybe a bit strange. This is The Song of the Sea, and then we watched Wolf Walkers as well on Apple Plus, which was their newer one that was nominated for an Academy Award last year. They were both excellent. This one, Song of the Sea, is about a Selkie, another Selkie girl tale.
Hyper-stylized animation, very, very different than you would normally see.
Our two-year-old especially loved this one. Wolf Walkers is, it's a little bit more like Secret of Kells. It does have some darker themes about the church condemning Irish fantasy and myth in favor of the king, and you know it's got an English takeover of Ireland in that one. So it was set in the 1600s, I want to say. So just a little bit more serious than Song of the Sea. This one is, I don't know. They both kind of have their moments of peril. I think if you have a child who gets worked up and tense easily, these both this one and Wolf Walkers have quite a bit of peril in them. They both end well, but just so you know, if that's something that, you know, bothers your child, this wasn't just a fun animated romp that, you know, nothing happened in. So just so you know.
Absolutely.
But really great. I mean, really great.
So next one is The Water Horse Legend of the Deep.
Yeah, so this was this is a Loch Ness monster. It is set against the backdrop of World War II, so there's some war stuff in there. It was a family movie, but just so that you know, if you have sensitive learners, we enjoyed this one. It wasn't my favorite. It was one of them I could have skipped, but the kids loved it because of all the Loch Ness monster stuff. And then the last thing
we did, Brave.
We watched Brave on Disney Plus, and I mean, Brave is always fantastic.
Brave is always
what am I gonna say? It's always good. We loved it. And we didn't watch The Sword and the Stone on Disney Plus, although that would be a good one too for Arthurian legends. We just watched that a few months ago, so we didn't rewatch it.
I would be remiss if I didn't say I tried to get my six-year-old to watch first few minutes of Monty Python Holy Grail. She liked the coconuts.
That is not appropriate, actually.
But I lost her about 2 minutes into the show, so I'm going to keep working on it, so don't worry about it. I know the fans are concerned.
You have to like do clips, because there's sections of that I don't think are appropriate.
They would expect me to show this to my dog. Anyway,
so.
Moving on. So we did a lot of videos. Obviously, we were trying to stay with the TV cinema because we were
so sick,
laid up on the couch. We did a lot of Rick Steves. We've talked a little bit about it before, that we really enjoy Rick Steves. We took a long Europe trip so long ago. We should
six
years ago. And Rick Steves helped us all the way through Europe. So we have a kind of a soft spot for that. And so we watch a lot of Rick Steves videos. It's a great mix of like history, education, kind of a little bit of a goofy dude, and kind of fun, you know, kind of humorous and everything. We really recommend if you're going to be doing some walkabouts or you're looking for sites and events that you want to see, Rick Steves does a great job. They're fantastic. Most of the episodes are on YouTube. They're free to watch. And there's some longer clips. They're like 30 minutes long. And then there's some shortened clips. They're like 2 to 3 minutes long, and they'll tell you little stories about different sections of wherever
sites to see,
wherever you're going. So we'll be recommending a lot of Rick Steves over the next two and a half, 3 months while we're in Europe.
Yeah. And our daughter is in the parent partnership program a couple of days a week, and she's taking Irish step dancing. And so as we were starting this, she was just going to be taking her first class. So we watched a lot of Irish step dancing videos.
We listened to a lot of Irish step dancing music.
We listened to tons of music. So that was really our big focus.
The drums reverberating in my brain.
Yeah, we watched a lot of dancing videos and mm-hmm. things, and so, you know, this was a fun study. There was a lots mm-hmm. of cooking and extra things that I wanted to get to that just unfortunately we just really couldn't because we weren't feeling well. But we did really enjoy it.
That is about to change because we are crossing the channel. The boozes are heading south. We're going into France. And so we are going to cook our way through France. Promise you on that one.
Yeah, crepes are coming.
We already started today. We've been watching a bunch of videos today. We read a bunch.
With Beauty and the Beast.
Beauty and the Beast on Sunday. So it's been a nice start to the whole journey. So we're into France. We'll catch up in a couple of weeks. If you have a chance, check out our resource guides below. If you're just starting North America and South America, it's a great place for you guys to begin. I know it's kind of the beginning of the year mm-hmm. when we've released this. So we started a little bit earlier this year, so if you're just starting now, it's a great place to start down in the resource guides.
Yep.
That was fun. It was a great trip through the British Isles.
We're so glad to be feeling better.
We are so... You have no idea.
It was bad.
It has been such a long journey. We're on to mainland Europe. We're going to spend a long time here, so we're really excited about it. We're going to cook our way through Europe. It's going to be absolutely fantastic. So hope to see you in about 2 weeks, and...
Stay tuned.
Stay tuned.